The brother standing next to me, who flew from Europe this morning to be with us and to be a face of saving the national treasure called the United States Postal Service, is going to speak to this convention today, brothers and sisters. And he had a birthday this week, and we're going to sing to him, happy birthday. And it's going to be the full version. Happy birthday to you. I don't think we're going to have any objection to hearing some words from a terrific social activist, a well-known actor, producer, conscience of the people of this country out there with the Nissan workers trying to organize into the UAW in Mississippi, a product of postal work, a product of postal worker parents, who believes deep in his heart, as we do, that a government of, by, and for the people is really a government of, by, and for the working people primarily. Sisters and brothers, it is a tremendous honor to introduce to you, on behalf of all of you, on behalf of the executive board, brother Danny Glover.
How are you doing, my brothers and sisters? My brothers and sisters from the APWU, American Postal Workers Union. Let me tell you how proud I am to be here. And I say that in the most humble way, how proud I am to be here with you this afternoon. I'm not going to tell you how I got here. That's irrelevant, but I'm here, and that's the most important part. And there are some people to thank for that. You know, there's Mark Dimmelstein. There's Liz. There's Tony. There's Debbie. They're the ones who made this happen. We had a simple meeting, and we talked about the state of the post office, state of workers. And you know something, is in life you don't have, as you all know, you don't have control over when you were born or where you were born. You're born at that particular point in time under certain circumstances, and those moments can be historical in some way. I was born 68 years ago in San Francisco, California. That was the first step. But most importantly, what happened was when my parents became postal workers in 1948, let me give some kind of context to this. The U.S. Armed Forces were desegregated in 1947. The federal workplace was desegregated in 1948. My parents came to the post office. My father, who had served in the military during World War II, my mother, who had graduated from a small college in rural Georgia and had found their way to San Francisco, and became postal employees. It literally set in motion circumstances that I didn't have control over. But one thing is that what I understood in the midst of a civil rights movement, that my mother and father, as a young child, were engaged in change. Not only had the demographics of the post office changed, bringing substance and bringing position and bringing jobs to African Americans, for the first time in the public space. Not only had that changed, but it was in the midst of a great movement in this country as well. And really, if we look at labor and the expansion of the public service sector, the expansion of public workers, is right after World War II. So they came at the hest of this moment, this great moment in this country's history, providing and building a middle class, expanding infrastructure, building schools, building housing, building small business. All this was happening at this particular point in time. I was born into that. And because my parents lend their voice from the outset, my life was guided by their passion, guided by that wisdom, guided by their involvement, engagement. My life became guided by that. So this union of postal workers, I worked at the post office during those moments when you were able to work a week or two during Christmas, where they hired us who were high school students. I worked, my sister was a clerk and worked at the clerk at the post office before she went on to finish school and became a wonderful, wonderful elementary school teacher. My brother was a mail carrier. And so all of this was part of our family, but the groundwork is laid at the beginning with our parents. And what was so impressive for me as a young child, what was so had such an impact on me, is the way they felt about the union. It was not just what they did. It's the way they felt about the union and making the workplace a better place, not only for my family, but for workers around the country. In fact, my father went to the conventions of the National Alliance of Postal Employees every year until he was 80 years old. More than 17 years after he had retired from the post office. That's how much he believed in the union. That's how much faith he had in the union, and I underline faith, because the union represents that. Martin Luther King said the best anti-poverty program he'd ever known was a union, was organized labor. So they have the opportunity to be here with you today. They not only talk about the past, because we know the past, there are great moments in this past, in this movement, among organized labor. We had the AFL-CIO here today, this week. We had Reverend Barber here. We've had other leaders here from labor here. Because they know it's a moment right now, at this point in time, where we stick together. We got to come together and we got to stick together. We got to support each other. We got to build with each other. The old stories were great stories. The old stories of Filipinos coming to the workplace, coming to the post office, or Hispanics coming to the post office, and others. Those are old stories, the immigrants coming to the post office. Those are old stories, but we have new stories that we have to create. Those new stories are what we have to do here in the 21st century, because so much has changed. Automation has changed so much. The evisceration of power of labor unions, the attempt to compromise our one great victory, that of collective bargaining, is on the line. All those are the things that we have to fight, still fight for. There's no time to rest. There's no time to lay down and rest on our laurels of generations ago. The time is now for us to create this new story. What does it look like? What does it look like? Because the post office is a national treasure. The first thing the Continental Congress set up was the post office. They understood the importance of people communicating, a new country communicating. They set up their post office. They established that. The first thing they did. So we have to treat it as a national treasure, as a way in which citizens, because that's what we are too, citizens are introduced to the way in which we treat each other and how we honor each other and how we build with each other. Because the post office was always about building a country too. And those of us who come to the post office in the last part of the 20th century and into the 21st century are going to talk about the same thing. How do we build a better country?
How do we build a better workforce? How do we build better citizens? And that's what this argument is about. This is what this discussion. So here we have true democracy right here. Real organic democracy happening right here in the post office, and we're all here to participate in it. So we have a lot of work to do. When I talk to Mark, and when I talk to Liz and Debbie, and when I talk to Tony, I said, I'm in. Provide me some marching orders so we can be part of this work. Because what I see now is a quote that students in Jackson, Mississippi, and Canton, Mississippi, working with Nissan workers down there, who simply want to have a vote so they can have a union, the choice to have a union. What they say, and we have to say it, that workers' rights are civil rights. That workers' rights are civil rights. That's what we're talking about there. So the campaign that's building against Staples, the campaign to use the post office for the many varied services it has the capacity to do be used for is important level because it reestablishes, it reintegrates that into our lives, the post office and the lives, and says that we own it, that we the people own this post office. Not private, not the private sector, not big business, but we the people own the post office. And we're gonna fight for that and stand up to that. And I know that we'll win. Thank you very much.
Sisters and brothers, we know we can't win these fights alone. What a great representative Brother Glover and others like him will be as part of our fight to save the public postal service. And again, a huge thanks for making a yeoman's effort to be able to come before you and us and address us this morning. He was first coming Thursday, then he was coming Tuesday, then he was coming Friday, and all had to do with travel all over the world. So we are extremely pleased and extremely humbled and extremely proud. Microphone number 6 had a privilege. Mike, next, please.
Ed Thompson, Fort Worth Area Local. I'd like to ask the chair if Danny Glover is an honorary member.
It will accept, we'll certainly accept the motion of that. Would you like to make a motion, brother?
So moved.
There's a motion on the floor and seconded to make Danny Glover an honorary member of the American Postal Workers Union. Let's vote. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, our union grows again. Brother Danny Glover is an honorary member of the American Postal Workers Union.
When I was struggling as an actor, sometimes
I would stop by where my mother worked, the post office there on 7th and Mission in San Francisco. I don't need any of you from San Francisco, you know when the post office at 7th and Mission. They both had worked at Rinkin Annex for a while. And I would stop down there just to see my mother smile. And you need, sometimes you need that when you're struggling, you know? And so she said, come on here, come on, Danny. I want you to meet some people who I work with. I want you to meet, oh, Mom, come on. I said, come on now. You know, I said, come on. So I go up there, and she said, I want you to meet my son, Danny. He's an actor. And it's like they were new words in her mouth. You know, she had just new words she was saying. And the people say, oh, he's an actor. And just about when they were about ready to say, well, what has he done? Which I hadn't done anything. She would say, just when they got ready to say, what has he done? She said, well, he hasn't done anything yet. But one day, he's going to do something important. And I would say to my mother, say, being here with you is that something that's important. That's what she...